Good evening, welcome to the December 12th Architecture and Historic Review Board meeting. I just heard from someone in the audience that the governor has awarded the Keeper's House some special mention. Steve could, and also Steve was, mentioned in that. So we want to congratulate him and congratulate the village for something, a lot of hard work and a long time running, but finally finished.
Yeah, okay, well, this is sort of like a shameless promotion department, right?
Yeah, well, I at least started.
It was really the friends of the Croton Aqueduct who a long time ago got the grant, made a grant application and got a grant for $500,000 from DOT, a transportation enhancement grant. It started the ball rolling. And so we, after maybe 12 years later, which is the problem with DOT grants, don't ever take the DOT grant. Don't have a lot of bake sales to raise the money instead. But in any event, Thursday, we were one of five projects that the governor awarded a preservation award to. And we were happy to get it, and it was in very good company with a bunch of, a very competitive field of projects from around the state. And so the friends and our office got this very nice award, and we're very happy to have completed this first phase of the project. And now that it's being used, there's a great exhibit that's there. Everybody should go see this new exhibit because it really describes the history of the aqueduct and certainly of this house. So it's one of three remaining houses. It's the only one that's on the aqueduct. There's one in Ossining that was moved off the aqueduct, and there's another one in Yonkers that was just discovered by Steve Oakes, the director of the trail, which has also been moved off the aqueduct. So this is the one that's remaining, and it'll be a great center for visitation and Dobbs for going forward.
Yeah.
Right.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Our first item on the agenda is 420 Broadway. I do not believe we have received any drawings. Anything come through?
There was communication from the applicant, said they indicated that they were going to be here tonight with the drawings. They were late getting them out, but
okay.
We'll see them.
All right, we'll continue 420 Broadway to the next meeting. Do you have a second?
Second.
Yeah, your seconds. Unanimous. 20 Judson Avenue. Anyone here from 20? No. How many times have they been on?
Four.
I'd like to take them off the agenda until we hear back from them. Is any motion required for that action? We just make a motion to remove them from the agenda. All right.
I'll
do so. Yeah, your seconds. Unanimous. 75 Main Street, please.
So this is a continuation on last meeting. Since last meeting, we retained a consultant to evaluate the brick and to recommend the right process for the next week. So that's in progress right now. We're still waiting for the board of the village to retain a consultant. So that's where we're at with that.
Yeah, just to keep you abreast and everyone else here, we received a few recommendations from Mr. Tilley. We looked at some of those people. I called several of them. We found that one was particularly qualified and seemed like the right candidate. I asked her for a proposal. She owes me that. I was hoping it would be to us by the end of last week, which it wasn't. But hopefully that will be forthcoming soon, and we can get that person on board to both, to do several things. You know, one, sort of serve as a general consultant, but also to help us manage some of the other specialty consultants who are looking at very specific things like the brick treatment, just what chemical wash is going to be used to remove the paint, and
right.
what kind of, you know, whether or not we think ultimately the repainting of the brick is the correct approach, which is something, you know, we're all entertaining, or perhaps some other treatment. So I'll keep Ed, you know, as soon as we receive something, I'll make sure Ed has that, and we'd like to hire that person as soon as we can so that we can keep this process moving.
Okay, and then, so I wanted to bring you up to speed on how the back is evolving, and I actually have a new architect we brought on board as part of our team, Chuck Eldred, and he's going to present where we are with the back right now.
Great.
I just wanted to show a couple of photographs of the existing conditions as a sort of reminder. The O'Shanna building in front and the warehouse building to be converted into an enclosure for the garage in the back. And on the right side, I'm also showing some of the things that I've been looking at a little bit. You know, images of kind of industrial architecture. The top and bottom ones are pretty local. Most people know them. The others are there really to show this kind of idea of some of the materials that come into play, sometimes metal or wood, or some of the mix of materials and the kind of scale of industrial or commercial architecture. Four things that I want to go through tonight. Interior planning, not for the interior design so much, but just so everyone can understand how it's starting to affect the massing of the building. Especially good group. That building massing in relation to the agreed upon zoning envelope. Third thing, just some concepts for apertures or window openings in relation for the setting up relationship between the new building and the existing buildings. For those three items, I'd say we've come a fair ways and you know, we got some concepts that we're pretty pleased with. Fourth, building materials and window types, preliminary concepts. We wanted to kind of bring you up to speed on to our thinking about some earlier ideas, but it's sort of more in the process. So first is the planning in relation to the massing. Here, this is the ground floor plan and the entry. I just want to point out in a second. Here, just a couple of features. Entry lobby is set back from the face of the building to create a kind of a notch or a gap between the existing building here and the new building. We've set it up with a kind of entrance sequence in to one side, possibly a garden or an area for some seating. There is a level change between the existing grade here and the new building, or the old building rather. And so we're looking at having the elevator come into play with a door on either side to negotiate that change. On the first level up, basically the main sort of feature affecting the outside is a kind of L-shaped outdoor terrace on the west and south. There's four units. Coming in from the public spaces, an elevator lobby opens onto a function room, perhaps an exercise room, or a common space for the building. As we move up to the second level, in the entry, in that little slot or gap, the building steps back there, and there would be a small outdoor deck or terrace. And then the apartments from this level up are duplexes. This is the stairways in the middle. And then this, I guess, is the key with regards to the massing. Besides the main terrace down below, stairs come up into a study. This is in the kind of pitched roof portion. We are being allowed to use 50% of the floor plate on this level. So you can see there's a kind of undulation from some storage areas back in to glazing at four corners that enclose bedrooms. And then the feature here is to carve away outdoor space for the units, an exterior terrace. And then the other issue here is, since this is the kind of sloped roof below, it's getting some headroom here. So then this brings us to the second issue. There'll be massing in relation to the zoning envelope. So here we have the kind of basic envelope that I've highlighted in the new building. The roof showing those kind of cuts into the roof area, and then also a couple of projections to get the head height in that area at the top of the stairs and the mezzanine. Again, down here you can see this would be the entry area, trying to keep this sort of base course going across, and then a new entrance to the garage, which would be basically the next two windows, eliminating them, creating a frame, and then glazing in the existing garage entrance. And then this is the terrace level in this kind of slot. You can see we've sort of carved away in the space there. So this slide is basically the same image, but we've just overlaid the building envelope from the zoning onto it. So you can sort of see again here, we're reaching the height at the top. There's some kind of minor adjustments at the eave, but basically we're fitting within the envelope. We're sort of not using some of this area in here. And then there's other areas that project outwards with some gabled ends. So in effect, we're sort of using some of those projections, proposing to use that more in the middle than at the ends. And here we have the west elevation. I just want to point out one thing here, is that we're looking at providing more, instead of sort of one more monolithic roof profile, we're looking at carving away at the roof to bring some proportions a little more in scale with the existing building. This also has the benefit for us of kind of hopefully buying some light to this unit back here in the corner, perhaps a little bit of a view as well. And you can see sort of on the sides, those dormers projecting. And again, here's the same exercise, so you can see the kind of cutaway in the middle, and then the extra gables, and then our dormers sort of projecting outward of that slightly. And this I just wanted to include, since I know it's a little difficult to read in the elevations, this would be an image of the kind of southwest corner of the building, where you can see the glass into the bedroom and the L-shaped terraces, and how that would work. And also the proposed initial version. Third item is the window openings, just briefly. The color in the next slide, but basically what we're looking at is picking up on the window openings and the apertures in the Oceana building. In fact, you can quite see that, but they're basically the exact same size of window openings and a similar spacing as well, to kind of link the scale of the two buildings. Although I kind of show these two slides here together, this would be just an image, quick image, of if you centered the windows on the rooms. So this, by way of saying, we haven't kind of positioned them precisely. And there would be some work to do just to ensure that the interior works as well as the exterior. But I think the Oceana building as well varies again, the same thing on the west side. Here, slightly closer together, but we're also kind of looking at possibly slightly larger window here on the west. There's the view out to the river, especially this time of year. And then on the lower level, the openings onto the terrace in both of those apartments, you recall from the plans, but those are both living, kind of all living space there. So it's kind of open out of that continuous living space. The last item is building materials and window types. These are sort of more preliminary things that, we're starting to look at. Again, the first three, I feel like we're pretty far along in working with the envelope and the interior and getting some of the features we'd like. But here, we have three concepts. The first one is would be a brick concept. This obviously would be to create a strong visual connection to the existing building. In this version, we'd be using or proposing, it's hard to read on the drawing, I apologize, but sort of more of a factory sash type window. So there's kind of two things going on. One is sort of wall cladding, and then the other are window types, and to some extent, they're sort of mix and match. But here you can see sort of looking up from the corner, a view. And this one, the idea obviously is to use the wall material create the link. It's a bit tricky, of course, given that there's probably two different types of brick on the building already. So, you know, we need to look more closely at that to fine-tune the exact linkage. And here you can see the view looking a little bit more towards the entrance. And there you can see the setback of the glass and also the sort of a small canopy. Just to sort of call out the entrance when looking down the street. In this version, slightly different roof showing two skylights to match the Oceana building. The second concept that we've been working with is either wood or some sort of plank material. And the idea here is to, instead of linking so strongly visually to the Oceana building, would be to provide contrast. So here you can see in this one, two things going on. First of all, the brick of Oceana sort of rises behind the new addition and then comes in underneath to create a kind of setting. Also the roofs would have a connection with a standing seam metal. And then in between, in the new part, sort of a contrasting material, something with a kind of a lighter weight, so it's visually lighter weight. So not a masonry, unit masonry concept. Also here, we're showing the double hungs in Oceana, and then using the exact same window in the new building, but then with the kind of twist that it's in a different context or a different color. This is a dark sort of charcoal or black, a deeper stain, but it's open. It could be a lighter, more close to natural wood. So, and also point out that the garage windows then actually have a relationship to the attic windows of Oceana. So there's a kind of continuity there with the contrast. And again, the view from the corner. And here's some of the view looking towards the entrance. And then the third material concept that I've been working with is metal, some type of metal cladding. Again, it's in this notion of sort of a contrast, but also trying to find a kind of a sturdy or strong material expression that's also industrial, kind of keeping with that aspect of Oceana, that goes sort of commercial grade, as it were. The other thing then here, besides the material, is the windows. And as opposed to the previous scheme, which was matching the Oceana windows exactly, we're also looking at a window type that is more tuned to the interior and to the views out with a fixed a picture window and then an operable fence on the side. And again, here you can see that idea of the bricks sort of forming this setting and then the lighter weight, but still looking for something that has a kind of clarity and simplicity that can kind of hold its own with the Oceana building. And then here's the last image, again, from the entrance. And this one, you can see the dormers that were from the initial part of the study at the top of the stairs, as opposed to the skylights. The last thing is if you notice down at the base, by the time you get to the corner, that southwest corner, it's a 20 plus foot high wall of brick. So I'm also kind of looking at the possibility of some type of base or sort of wainscoting, just kind of around the building horizontally a little bit, set up the kind of corner garden or mini park at the end, and break up the height of that the wall as well. So those would be the two other features in this scheme. And that's basically where it stands. Again, we're pretty confident in the first part with the zoning envelope and the interior planning, and now, in effect, sort of, kind of bringing into the process a little bit regarding our thoughts on materiality and how best to create a strong relationship from the new building to both Oceana, and then also to pick up on the scale of the neighborhood as well. Whether kind of all brick scheme is better that links more closely to Oceana, or something with other types of materials that perhaps can take advantage of the pitched roof and some more domestic scale built into the zoning envelope and into the massing that could link it potentially, keeping its integrity but kind of giving a nod to the domestic scale.
We open a new discussion on the future of this building. I welcome it. Obviously, there is a lot of potential and possibilities. I guess we need to digest. There is a lot to digest and a lot of to work with. And looking forward for the challenge. I think I see a lot of issues that come up. Probably you'll see them here. You are considering yourself as well. Clearly, this building is Taipei, industrial building, end of the century, with some transformations during the last 100 years. There is the base that is 1950s, that is serving some purpose. I don't know if it needs restoration, but it is what it is. And the new addition, which it has to relate to the three of them. I don't know if the base is doing what's supposed to be doing, or is integrating to the scheme, or how the base integrates, the old base, I'm saying the base to the 50s addition, right? To the, how it relates to the old Oceana and to the new addition. In terms of massing, I guess, I have a lot of comments, but clearly the way that you are trying to work with it's appropriate. It's one way to doing it. But I think there is a lot, a lot to digest and think at this point.
Well, I will just give you my initial impressions of the presentation. I'll start with what I think is working really well, and then we'll sort of work through some of those things. I And I think your link between the, I'll call the new portion and the portion of the garage, all, you know, all the sort of new building, and I think your link is working quite well. I think the introduction of the setback in the outdoor space helps quite a bit in the separation of the two buildings. To go back to another massing issue, I think it would be valuable for us, for the community, to entertain some alternative roof massing concepts. I'm sure you've looked at some of those, and maybe this is the most intelligent proposal that that exists. But I think bringing some of those studies to us for at least some, just for us to look at, for us to digest a bit, for us to discuss as options and other possibilities would be valuable. Going to a little, maybe slightly more specific issues regarding the materials, I would in theory believe that introducing a new material would be right, but I think with the scale of the new building, that the most sort of harmonious material will be the brick. I think that what will allow you a little bit of play between what is, you know, obviously a new building is how you treat the opening. And I think in just diagrammatically, the between the two window opening options you had, the one that was symmetrically oriented, but perhaps on the exterior, but not on the interior, was a stronger diagram. Now, when you start to put in more details for window, that thing can change, but I think that may be the better approach. I welcome some variations in what exactly those windows are, whether they are sort of large picture types to capitalize on views, or they are somewhat more in keeping with the existing older building. I think probably the former is more appropriate given the roof line and the types of cutouts you have, which are more, which have a nod to the existing building but are obviously more contemporary. So I think that may be the way in which you can explore something playful in terms of the apertures. I don't know that you need to match the window of the Oceana building in the new building.
Okay.
I think that there are ways that one can relate to that opening, either through size, proportion, you know, rhythm, as opposed to necessarily the same muntin arrangement sash style or whatever.
I would bring just a reference there.
I would reference the datum lines and the proportion of the opening. That to me, I think, is the primary concern. And then the detail of the window, I think, can be explored in some other way that maybe capitalizes on views in a, you know, in a way that the heavily muntin window, you know, sometimes impedes. You know, I think you have the right strategy regarding the roof material. I think maybe the next big question is the garage door, which I see you've somewhat averted, although I do see a big, heavy casing, I suppose. I'm not sure what what that is, but I, you know, the garage door in its previous incarnation was, you know, on the other street, and you know, we paid a lot of attention to that, and so did the community, and so I think, you know, and this is a thing I walk by twice a day, and have a real interest in seeing done in the best possible way from the street experience, you know, from walking by that thing, not only seeing something pleasurable, but also something, you know, a way that's safe, makes one feel comfortable about walking up that street. When I walk to the train in the morning, there's kids, a lot of kids are going on the way to the bus stop. And so I think some treatment of that, some real close attention to that, and that big picture window which I'm not sure what that's looking into. Also critical in the next, you know, as you take the next few steps.
I just wanted to make a comment. Is picking up the proportions of the windows of the Oceana and transferring to the island, it's one way of doing it. Or the transformation between one and the other. The other one I would refer to the latest Tate edition, Tate Modern edition.
Sure.
That they kept the same bricks, but it's a total transformation.
Right.
And I think it's very successful, but in the treatment of bricks, so in other words, if you keep on the bricks and transform totally different openings, it also it works as well as just by carrying the materials.
Right.
And pretty much what you're doing on the roof is it's totally acceptable and it's looking promising. I think the biggest issue is the relationship of, my problem is the relationship of the top to the base. That somehow, I don't know.
Can you go back to the first scheme and in the same image?
The ombre scheme?
Yeah.
Yeah, that seems to be, you know, they would because the transformation is a little more subtle, and
let me interject. I disagree with both of you.
Okay.
I believe that trying to match the brick of the Oceana building and to do it successfully, it will not be as readily achievable, and by inserting another material, whether it be the wood or the metal, is more respectful of the residences around the community. It's more in line with the keeping of the rest of the block as you move down the block, and it brings that smaller scale into play. So it downsizes the scale of this new addition. I think the massing is really very interesting and respectful of the larger scale building, and it brings it down to a smaller community level. I also think altering that base in the final scheme, where you bring the base up and create a new line or a new datum line, also adds another scale element that improves upon that existing base building. The existing base building is very unattractive and very large on that palisade side. It becomes extraordinarily deep, and by scaling that up a bit, it creates more of a band, and it also connects the base as more of a podium that everything rests on.
Mm-hmm. What material are you considering for the watermark?
And that's exactly my problem.
Well, I haven't gotten into too much detail. I mean, probably, you know, a granite, perhaps for durability, or, you know, a limestone for a kind of historical, you know, yeah, consistency. Perhaps a precast for budget, but it's something.
The other thing that's interesting is the setback with the inclusion of the patios, which you don't really demonstrate as fully as you might, is that there is that line of planting that now can occur above the street level, which can be cascading down the building or at least have some sort of green element that rings that building, which could be a very positive thing. Maybe there's an actual planter that's incorporated into that line of that edge.
I think it
can soften it. Against
what condition is the plinth, that base at the back? We're obviously going to pay close attention to how the brick is treated on the Oceana building, but as this later addition, I mean, is there what sort of shape is it in, and how does it relate? I mean, what is the brick quality versus the brick at the main building?
It's not good, as I recall it, especially sort of the lower down you get. Thought with the sort of baseline course was perhaps we could protect / conceal it a little bit. You know, this is in my recollection, or of course, so the higher up you go, the better it is. Or, you know, whereas down by the street level, it's starting to fall quite a bit. You know, the base is going to fall off, so it's not.
Which I think it may, that the watermark may help that. Right. If it's
right.
Got it's in, if it's in bad condition, you're able to, and I do, Dale. I agree. I think changing. I think trying to achieve the existing brick finish and or refinish or restoration, and then continue that onto a new structure and a new construction won't be as effective as you may think, just because of an ability to match. And it's the subtle, it's the inconsistencies of what is the Oceana building right now that gives it its character, especially after restoration. And you really likely, without some very careful consideration, won't be able to, I mean, trying to, you know, match an inconsistency, how does that work, right? So an alternate material does, I think, play well.
Yeah, I'm not proposing that the new building match exactly the existing one. I think, I mean, there are several things at play. One is that there may be some of that brick may ultimately end up being painted. The new brick could be just, you know, its similarity is in its material typology, not in an exact match. I mean, and I think there are good examples of quote unquote mismatched brick working much better than matching brick. And, you know, I can think of a number of projects of, you know, the historical nature in which that was employed. And then there was no intention to try to mimic a 100-year-old plus brick. The intention was to patch it and show it as a patch and show it as a sort of, you know, a new part and a new piece of the narrative. And so this could ultimately be that. I feel the datum line at the base introduces an alien form and into this building. You know, I think it's a big ugly base is what it is. And I think if you can make the material, you know, if that gets repaired, replaced with something done more delicately, and the openings are done right and plantings are done right, I think that will mitigate that big heavy base that's so harsh on us. Because when you walk down that street, when you're walking by the building, you know, it's an immense wall on the street, and it doesn't feel imposing. What feels imposing is you get down towards the end, and there's no openings, or the openings are up high. And, you know, I maybe there's a way to pull down those.
That's why I like the base, because it brightens that base. Your eye level is not no longer that red brick; it's that stone. Could be a more attractive stone.
I think the concept of the podium is problematic with the addition. That's a podium. If you integrate the base with as an A and B, like the Oceana building at the new addition, which is integrated, I think it's the right way to do it.
Well, so are all of us, and so is everyone else. I don't think we're going to reach any sort of conclusion today.
I understood that on the last slide.
the comment is that it's not that A, B, C, it's A and B.
Right now,
integrate
as strongly as possible to the Oceana building.
Integrate the podium to the top addition.
The garage in the top.
Somehow has to be one.
The actual articulation.
So one of the things that try to work in that direction is the unifying materials in terms of brick overall. It's brick. It's even if it's not 100% match or doesn't have to match or what I agree with. You know, there are many, many successful additions that they don't match and they work. Mm-hmm. And the transformation of the use of the skin of the brick in a new way, it worked. It could be very successful.
I agree. It would be very difficult. That would be impossible to match. That wasn't my intention.
We're not.
It's sort of even shown as a bigger, just a different, slightly different texture. But of course, as you know, it could be many different either shapes of, you know, proportion of brick or materials and coatings and so forth.
Yeah.
Good. We look forward to that. I know there are a lot of people here from the community who are very interested in this project. If there's anyone who would like to come up, and yes, please.
Thank
you. I just wanted to add, as a completely unqualified person to make this comment, so please consider the source. I think one of the things that makes the Oceana building so charming is the, well, the, portions of the windows and the lintels and the sills. And it'd be lovely to see, you know, some consideration of maybe carrying, maybe that's the way to carry, a way to carry the connection over into the back building, just the floor.
Thank you.
Thank you, and welcome aboard. Utilities, 22 Wall Street, and I think it reads a lot to digest. I think there were a lot of useful comments from the board members, and I tend to agree that you don't want to try to make too much out of the base, because if you start to, the data on it, then you're going to start to really call attention to it, and it's sort of a, I sort of tend to agree that it's the base, which is sort of the arm of the Oceana, you know, for better or for worse, reaching out. And somehow I would have thought that I would have wanted to see a modern material or the industrial metal thing. I think the wood thing doesn't seem right, it just seems too lightweight. And the metal thing, I would have thought that I would have liked that, but I tend to agree with the chairman's comments that somehow there's a certain sense of it needs a kind of weight, a sense of weight back there. And not the same brick, but you know, some kind of, you know, heavy thing with the appearance of a heavy, smaller thing back there. And it sort of contradicts what my initial impulse would be or my theory about new and old. But somehow it's feeling like maybe it does need to be masonry or something. And the bricks, I mean, as all of you know, that it takes about 5 different bricks to make. You discover, if you're looking at a brick building, you discover there are 5 different kinds of, you know, shades in that brick, so that, you know, you can pick up on something that would be compatible. But anyway, I think it's promising, and I agree that the roof, you know, it'd be great to see the other roof studies, because that's in a way the key. And a different window type, it seems to me, is fine.
Mike Nero, 42 Walnut Street. A couple points of probably more of process than of architecture. This has gone through the Board of Trustees as a single building on a single lot. So kind of feels funny when we're referring to this as a second building, as if it's a second lot. You know, I do like the idea of the roof, in that it mimics the other roof at least. But somehow, if this is not tied to the Oceana building, I think the public's expectation would be that it's tied to the rest of the neighborhood in which it sits, not the Oceana building. In which case, then we have a massive question. Because even though this is much smaller in height, this is double the width of the Oceana building, which is why the double peak kind of looks natural, because it mixes with the Oceana building's peak. But it's twice as wide. Which also means that when you look at not just the base, which is already large, but the whole entirety of the project, you've got a mass that's still probably somewhere in the size of 7 times the neighboring houses. So it doesn't really blend into the rest of the neighborhood unless it is a close match to the Oceana building, and we somehow tie that back into it as part of the continuum, not just in dressing up the ugly old warehouse that was in back of it before. You know, the specific feedback when I asked directly was that this is a single lot, that this had been joined. I know 50 years ago there were attempts to build on top of the warehouse when it was separate before the Oceana purchased it. Now, the argument argument was that when this was approved, everything in the process, including, as you know, the units were a separate issue because we have two zonings. But as far as the parking was determined based on a single building, not on two buildings.
Is this a comment based on my...
No, this is a comment...
My calling this to, you know, I mean, that was for ease of discussion in the presentation.
This was the presentation today, right? This was the second building is the presentation, right? You've been consistent with that presentation. What I'm saying is that presentation is inconsistent with the approval that went before the Board of Trustees as a single building. This was one project with one permit, not two buildings. Right, so this all...
But we haven't approved anything.
I know, I'm just saying, from a process standpoint, this is either something that we're considering as one unit, or we're really talking about something different from what is approved so far.
No, it's the former. And we are discussing this as a single project in which we approve one building, and we're looking at it in parts because it's complicated and because we need a lot of input from the architectural, the design team, the community, our board, the other boards, and so, you know, we've broken it up for logistical reasons.
Okay.
But it is one, we're talking about one building. Okay. I think this is one building. And I think what we have asked for from the beginning is some indication where the old and the new are differentiated from one another. And so, you know, in a sense, there are two parts to it. But I think we've agreed as a community to view this as one building and to proceed in that respect. So I don't believe that thing is a part of our board's discussion of how we think about this from here going forward. I think that thing has been established, you know, amongst a lot of intelligent people who have thought, you know, and worked hard on creating that. The planning board, the board of trustees, the community, the applicant, and I think that's a legitimate departure point for this board. We're dealing with one building. We have a reduced massing, which you're right, is still quite a bit larger than some of the neighboring houses, but I think, you know, is the right balance between something that has to connect to a very large building on one side of the site and something that has to relate to an important church in the community and the neighboring houses. And I think this is in the right direction. And one of the things that's critical is the roof line. I think this is an interesting example of how to resolve it, much better than the things we've seen in the past. But, you know, I think we still want to look at some of the other possibilities, just to be sure, in a public forum, that we've looked at those other opportunities, we've found the one that is most appropriate, and we're proceeding with that one. So I don't know that massing or this, the question you have about two buildings, one building, are really
sure,
so...
It's not being bifurcated into separate...
No, I don't
...separate
see.
Pieces, that this is all a continuum of the same process, that it doesn't get segregated. Because that's how it's been presented for the approvals.
These are all pre-submissions, by the way. There's no vote here.
Yeah,
there's
just
no.
Unlike other times, I'd hate to get to sort of the end of the process and then bring up procedural issues, right? When that may have some impact even on what you or anybody else views as what's the best solution architecturally. What do I want to see visually? Right? Visually is fine, but it still has to be within the approval.
Yeah, that's what else Ed helps us with.
Thanks.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, thank you everyone for your comments. Thank you for the presentation. I look forward to seeing you next time, I suppose. When you have information that comes through from your consultant, forward it on to us, and we'll look at it. We're not, we're all somewhat experienced with dealing with these things in our day jobs. Motion, this is not an application.
It is.
It is.
Continue.
Sorry, I misspoke. This is an application. So I make a motion, we continue this to the next year. Do you have a second?
No, second.
Yeah, your seconds? Unanimous? Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much.
Okay, 66 Florence Avenue, please.
Since our last meeting, I think David perhaps ran a talk to the post about if you have a set of plans that are approved, you should do what's been approved. So he's gone much further than what we talked about at the last meeting in terms of putting that together. We've got photos to show it, but what I wanted to kind of just do is toggle between what are, you know, this was the drawing that we put into you that shows all the things that we could have built differently. And this is showing the same. For example, he had put this window in on the side that half round, that's now been removed, and the two casement windows that were supposed to be there are there. We missed something in when we showed you those differences. These windows were originally pairs of double hungs, but they're pairs of triple casement, or triple casements, two of them. Which I think works fine because it's not one person, you know, that it was. But I did want to call that to your attention. But you guys seem okay with not having the bands, but he has put the bands in. So the band at the first floor and the band at the second floor have been installed, and the windows have been corrected. If you go to the other building, that had fewer differences on it.
We're looking at these individually. Is that right?
Right.
These are approvals. Let's go through one at a time, and if you would.
I think 66 is first on the agenda.
Yeah, let's go through 66 first, if you would.
66. Entrance on the right or entrance on the left?
Entrance on the left. If you're facing that.
So this one is 66.
For clarity's sake, walk us through what changes have been made since the previous meeting. Because I think we were all clear about what was approved, what was built, and what our issues were with the built differences. And
right.
So we gave you four or five items. If you would just go through those items and then also enumerate the items that we didn't insist upon, but you changed,
right.
Nevertheless.
So on 66, this had been done as a triple case instead of a pair of double hungs.
Yeah.
The double hungs have been installed. The porch was raised up to be even with the first floor. That has not been changed.
Which we were okay with,
It's good.
And the staircase works. There were four columns instead of two columns.
Yes, I see.
You guys were kind of going back and forth on that, but you moved the two interior columns.
Why, can you tell me why the lower portion of the stair at the entry is clouded? I don't remember that from the last meeting.
Because it's more steps than were originally approved.
Okay, fine.
The change of the level, the band had not been installed on the first floor or the second floor. Those have now been installed.
And that is now, that's now installed?
Correct.
Would you talk, could you, you have photographs in your presentation?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so we're going to look through those too when we're done.
There was a mistake in the way the drawing was done before. The architect in the drawing, he showed the floor plans having the kickout on the second floor, but he didn't show that in the elevation.
Yes.
So that, you know, that was built with the overhang and that has not been changed. On the back of the building, it was originally supposed to be stone where the fireplace was. That had been done with siding, but that has now been done in stone. So that's been done to match the building. So for the most part, with the exception of raising the porch, and I think there's some window got eliminated. Oh, the window in the basement got eliminated here. I think that was the only window that did. So everything else has been brought into compliance with the approved plans. Do you want me to skip to the photos on that one?
Please.
Please, yeah.
Okay, so...
No, that's it.
Yeah, I know. I'm going to pass. Okay, so here is... These are the photographs that were taken before the changes were made. You can see the triple casement. So these are those photographs showing it with the, you know, with the siding instead of the stone. And the missing bands. So this is now the state of the job. The window has been changed. The base has been put in. The trim has been added. Going all the way around. So I think that one. And
can you go back one photo?
Sure.
Yeah, there were four columns on that too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just wanted to see how you resolve the roof.
Yeah. This down comes in, and that piece of trim comes down into it. It's.
Okay.
Yeah. It's a little funky, but it's. I think it's been.
It's
you know. That's the back. And then just showing kind of around on the side. This just comes around and dives into the side of that roof. And that's that building. Any questions you have on that one?
Any comments?
I'm good.
You know, we it's pretty simple. We get an approval, you build the building, we never have to talk again. I think making these changes is what was right. The house looks good. It matches our approval, or for the most part, and the minor things that are different, I think we're okay with. So I'd like to make a motion to approve this. The changes are submitted.
We approve one by one, right?
One by one.
One by
just
one.
Just 66. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second.
Yeah, okay.
We're unanimous. Okay, we'll go to 60. Please.
So here was 60. The porch was raised up. There was a window that was eliminated here. There was missing bands. A window eliminated here. A window added here. Windows in the middle there. This window was different as designed, approved. There was a missing window there, but some minor changes with the deck, which there were a window that was eliminated there, and then the missing band. So what has been done is there was a window here, it has not been installed. There was a window here, there is one. That window was eliminated on the side. The front On the side, the east elevation, there was a window here that was not installed. The window that was supposed to be here has now been installed. The window that was supposed to be here has been installed. And the window that was not supposed to be there has been removed. And the bands have been installed on the building. I think that's most of the stuff. Get to the elevations. This shows so this is before this had the extra columns. You know, different things with windows. You know, here's that arch drop window, which is where the window was not installed where it was supposed to be, and this was a triple instead of a single. And that has now been changed. The bands have been put in. The two columns have been eliminated. These two triple casements have been left. The window that was installed that was added that has been left. The other window down here has not been installed, and the window on the back has not been installed. But I think everything ties together. The half ground window was eliminated, and these two windows that were supposed to be there have now been installed. The band coming around the back. I think what was coming out was basically resolved, so it's not, there's nothing hanging and kind of confused.
What triggered the added windows? The two added windows, one on the front elevation of the house and then the other on the west elevation? Because that's not...
Are you talking about these?
No, right hand, no. Very top right. And then around the corner, just
right,
on the other elevation, it's another window in the same, I guess, room?
Yeah, this window was added and there was supposed to be a window down here. It's actually the same window. It's put up instead of...
And you weren't able to continue to board across because of the window that's at the front elevation?
I think putting this in here would tie with that and off the way and kind of not intersect well with the way that roof works.
Which is probably why they didn't have the window there originally.
Yeah, do you have
the original drawing here in the presentation?
You should have the original in your set. You gave me the ones that was canceled.
If you happen to have a copy here we could look at, I didn't bring that with me. Tell us what's happening in the space behind that corner window condition.
You'd have to answer that. I don't really.
One more time.
Would you come up and take the mic and introduce yourself? There's a bit of a strange window location and misalignment on the upper right hand corner of the upper left hand drawing. And so if we can look at the photograph, which shows the three-quarter perspective. Yeah, there.
There you go.
Well, you have those two windows. The sills don't align. And actually, Patty, if you have the recent.
Yeah.
And there's a termination of the trim band, on the front of the house. And it looks like it's the result of a window that's a bit misplaced.
So what you're thinking is if this, would you eliminate that window?
Well, I'm looking at this.
Well, we want to know what is in plan that's causing the need for the two windows.
This is a June 30th, 2015 approved plan of the front elevation. And I believe that this is a more harmonious composition for a number of reasons. One, these windows are aligning. That's the two, the four larger windows on the first and second floor. And then there is a clear separation between the porch roof, that window above, and sort of the,
yeah,
what happens in the space on either side.
What happened? Are you talking about the window above the porch?
Well, there's a
the other one. The window above the porch is fine.
Yeah, and the porch has raised up, so that reduced the height, but I don't think that's probably...
And yeah, but there's no...
It's this window here, reading, which seems to not have a relationship. And the question they were asking, David, was, what inside this house, what's happening in that corner?
That's actually that's you know, the steps there.
The staircase?
Staircase.
The stairs.
Actually, you don't feel any kind of... the windows are the same thing.
And actually, just for my interest, perhaps, the window that was supposed to go here, which is actually this window, was a reason that couldn't be installed there.
That's correct.
Well, it's hitting one of the trays.
Yeah,
second tray.
It's
excuse me.
It's a landing, and then it just comes around.
I just think it looks really awkward.
Yeah.
It just doesn't. I mean, that window just being there. I mean, if you have light to the stairway from the other window, I think that might be a compromise to be able to continue the trim board. But the fact that the two windows don't align and the fact that you can't continue the board across just looks awkward. Doesn't look right.
If I understand the suggestion, it's that the window that's on this corner seems to have a poor relationship with the window around the corner. If it's bringing light to the stairs, this window already accomplishes that. And maybe, given the fact that there are other differences here, if you simply remove that one window,
you remove that window, you
continue the trim.
Bring the band right across into the room. That would work.
I'll go to a front elevation view real quick. There you go.
If that one is not there, it's less fine. You know?
Yeah, let's fix that. I think that's it. Any other comments?
Just for the sake of consistency, the drawings don't match the reality. The band, the trim is, I don't think it's the same as in the drawing.
It was 10 inch.
Yeah, but not in the drawing.
On the original drawing, you have 10 inch?
On the revised drawings.
Right, the
window and the
what's
window.
What's happening here?
And maybe there is a...
I didn't go into enough detail. We submitted that, 10 days ago. Or, this last week, whatever it was. David's been working since then. So I got these photos actually today, and it was work that was going on. So he was continuing to do work. So the trim he put on is the 10-inch trim. They were actually working from the original plans.
It was the same. No, I had it wrong in all the drawings.
I mean, there's an alignment with the top windows. But I think it's...
I think the slides is a little deformed. It doesn't. So might read differently. But should.
Is that a 10-inch trim board? That's the question.
That's correct.
It is.
Yeah.
I think we're okay.
We're okay.
And given this one additional change that we want to have made,
move this window and continue the band.
Correct.
Yes.
Are you comfortable?
Yes.
Yeah.
Make a motion. We approve this application with the stipulation, the upper right-hand window on the front north elevation be removed, and the 10-inch trim band be continued along the front to the porch.
Second. Pretty much dies into the porch.
Similar to the left.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Brandon seconds. Unanimous? No?
No.
No, we want to vote. They'll, vote against?
Yes, I'll vote against.
Yes. 6668 Main Street, yes. So, if I understand correctly, the set of drawings that were approved at this board were replaced or supplemented with a set of construction documents which included some changes.
Correct.
Are you going to discuss those changes?
Yes.
First?
What I'm going to do is I'm going to compare. This is the drawing that was approved by the architectural review. And what I'm going to do is show the drawings that were submitted, the building permit, really quickly, so that we can go through the design.
Okay. And then there's an additional step, which is that at some point in the construction process, some additional alterations were made
right.
to the permitted set.
That's correct. So
if you could just differentiate for us between those two sets of changes.
Okay, so this is the drawing that was actually approved by the architectural review board. I believe it was November 2014. These four elevations that I'm showing here are the elevations that were in the construction document set. For the most part, they're very consistent with what was approved, but there are differences. And what I'm going to do in a minute is show you what those differences are. So here's that again, and this is the same drawing that you were given, which shows the changes that have been made. So what we did is we took the architect's drawings, showing the change, you know, showing his, say, window configuration, and we then put it on our drawing, showing what the differences were and highlighting those with bubbles. So if you want, I can kind of walk you through perhaps elevation by elevation.
Yes.
Okay. So before we actually get to that, there's one change that was done pretty much right before the start of construction. They don't show it. But they went up and they figured out how the grade of the ramp coming up from the street works to the back. They needed to raise the first, the ceiling of the first floor, the floor of the second floor, they needed to raise that up about a foot to get adequate head height for the parking behind the building. But they knew they couldn't vary from the 46 feet that was measured and approved. So what they did is they took space out of the floors, reducing the floor to ceiling, and they changed the pitch of the roof that was built from a 2 and 12 to 1.5 and 12. So the combination of those things maintained the 46 foot that was approved. So that was a change that was done with discussion with the board. There's another change that was made, which I might as well mention now, which is that when they got the elevator design, the elevator housing needed to project up higher than the roof. So they came in, they discussed that. I don't know if it was with Ed or somebody in the building, with Brian. And they were permitted to put the housing in, breaking up through the roof approximately 3.5 feet at the low point, around 2 feet at the high point, so that they'd have the height for the elevator. In Dobbs, we don't count that. So I don't know that it's an issue with any measurements of such, but it is something with visual, and I do have photographs that will show what that is.
Yeah, so is that the extent of the changes that occurred between the set that was approved by us and the set that was permitted?
No, those are the changes that have occurred with kind of after construction. There's another one too. After construction started because of site conditions and what the details were coming. The third change that was made, this was originally supposed to have a full basement from side to side. When they started construction, they found that it was a very sandy soil. They also found that the buildings adjacent, the building to the south adjacent, does not have a foundation or a footing. So they did not want to do any excavation within a certain distance of that, so they reduced the size of the foundation. Again, I don't think that's an issue for this board, but those were things where they had a set of drawings, they started construction, they figured it out, and they couldn't really do what the drawing showed. So they came in, discussed it with the village, submitted revised drawings, and built what was in the revised drawings. Now, the changes I think you're talking about are different. Those are the ones that were made between our drawing in November 2014 and the drawing that was submitted for the building permit in August of 2015. And that has to do with a number of different things, and I think it's easiest to go over them. On Main Street, the windows in the middle were going to be casements. Those have been changed to double hungs. And similarly, the windows on the top floor were going to be casements. And those may have scheduled to be double hungs. The two doors on the roof deck coming out of the window shown as pairs of doors. They were originally shown as pairs of doors, and now they're single doors. I think that's everything on the front. If we go to the side, there were some shifts of windows that were done to accommodate the floor plans in this middle section. On the back here, we originally showed four windows wide with two double window dormers. Those were changed to three windows in width and two small single window dormers above. Also on this elevation, railings provided in the parking area to keep people from walking through there. Edge between the wall and the roof was simplified. We had variegated things going in and out. That's in the central portion of the roof edge. Inside and the other staircase is on the interior. And on the wanted to emphasize another change too, is we showed these four doors, six doors, we come out of the little portion, we showed those seven on the wall, and then it shifted so that the plan works better from center to the side, but symmetrical about the center mass. The north facade, again, you had a shift in the windows to accommodate the plan. On the interior, we added the railings on that so that people can't, you know, overhear. It's actually quite important because otherwise you could walk off that and have a change of level you weren't anticipating. So I think that's most of the changes in that. The only other thing that I would mention is that we originally talked about the roof being a standing seam metal, and now we're proposing that that be EPDM. Black EPDM.
Of course.
And this by facility.
God.
But what we've done is we've just listed out all the things. So those are, and those are things like the there can be a discussion about the EPDM versus the standing seam. But I think, I mean, what I've done for this is to identify those things so that you've got them, so you're aware of them. Armand is here, and he's a good builder, and I think he's got these changes, and I'd actually feel more comfortable if he was answering that correctly. It's an exception to you guys.
Well, let's go through then the two separate items. The first are these. The first that you went through are the construction-related changes. One that had to do with an adjustment of the parking level, first floor level, and the overall height, and as well as the small elevator equipment housing. I think those are. Those are legitimate construction-related issues that get brought to the building department. The building department makes a call. I think that that's the correct call. I don't have any concern about those, as long as you maintain the building height that we approved and, you know, essentially the character of the building. So I'm not concerned about those. I'll just, you know, when I look at the changes, you know, some of them are slight improvements. Some of them are really swapping out equal for equal when it comes to the metal panels at the wind below the windows, or, you know, some of the four windows versus the three windows on the, I guess what elevation is that? It's a slightly better elevation, which is hardly visible. The one really sort of outstanding problem here is the last item you mentioned, which is the EPDM roof. And, you know, I think if...
And the change in the pitch in the dormers, in the mansard roof.
That's interesting. Let's do one at a time. I'll tackle one, you tackle the other. If we're going to entertain a change, you would be using something equal or better. And I, in no way, is a standing seam metal roof, in no way is an EPDM roof an equal or better exchange from a standing seam one. And given the visibility of this, you know, it's on the hill, people come down, you're on the aqueduct. I think that that is just not even a topic for debate at this hearing. So you're welcome to share with us your rationale. However,
but before defending the EPDM, that I'm in full agreement with Michael. If we replace a material, it has to be equal or better. And that's a rule of thumb that we use. But the other changes that I see that are noticeable are rear elevation to the aqueduct. The pitch on the mansard roof changed on both wings, from 1 to 3 to something else. And on the same elevation, they are also different too. At least if they are symmetrical, well, we understand, but they're not. Also, the way that
you
treat...
You're not at the same pitch.
Sure.
Yeah.
original, you see this?
Yeah.
It's not that. On my sketch top,
right?
And right. This one is not equal to this, not equal to this even. So they are, it may be a
we
drawing
need to
problem.
Confirm. I think they've been,
they are all equal. But maybe it's a problem with the drawing then.
Yeah, I think so.
And then also the difference in the corners is this one doesn't wrap around the shoe. I don't know why.
Right. There's no reason that.
Can we put the drawing up and can we identify it so that everyone can see what we're discussing? Because you answered the second part of the Yair's question, but you didn't address the first part, which I think is the more critical. And the issue with the what I see is a different pitch here from what the approved drawing is that it no longer resembles a mansard roof, which was the intention was to make this fourth story appear smaller. Right? And so when you build a straight wall, or essentially a straight wall, you know, if you build it at 89 and a half degrees, it's really it doesn't break down. It's not a mansard roof. So that has to be addressed. That is another major.
The photographs show more of a mansard.
Please use the microphone.
The photographs show more of a pitch of a mansard than Cal's drawings do. So Cal's drawings, which, you know, the premise of that, show very sharp. When I look at the photos, and something we can obviously confirm is to go out and actually measure.
Yes.
But
why don't we start by having drawings that resemble the reality and how they differ from
our first task was to identify what these things are.
Sure.
So once we've done that, we've established that we have to know what your concerns are before we do anything else.
So to that end, and I know we had this in the initial submission, let's look at the section through there and let's provide us with the what the pitch of that mansard roof is, and you know I think that it's essential that we're building that roof.
Right, and part of this I think is that a lot of the articulation of that is something that gets built on the outside of the building. It's not something that's in the building. So I think that is it simply has not been built yet, but that's something I can confirm with Carmine and.
The roof pitch is the roof pitch, right? You've got, it says right here, 1 and 3.
Right, but if you look at,
Can we point it out on the screen so everyone can see?
If you look at the way this is built, it's very clean. It's a tight envelope at this point. But that is what's underneath what goes on top. So the details, there's nothing including the details on the drawing, done on this drawing. Cal's drawing also provides that same detail.
Yeah, but it's...
You know, he's got the cornice that's wrapping around, that the mansard's coming down. I don't think that this drawing is accurate to what's been built.
Yeah, but also there's not only an issue of accuracy, it's an issue of representation, but also the roof that you say that you limited the jokes on the fourth wall.
Right.
That was also a kind of an articulation that was just, there was a purpose for articulating that on the fourth, you know, the jokes and the character. Now all of that is lost, and the mansard roof less deeper, so the entire thing lost the character of the mansard roof. Colin,
the reason the mansard is steeper, from a structural standpoint, to have such to transfer the coin load down, the structural engineer felt in order to transfer the roof load on the over the mansard to the exterior walls, we could not have such a steep or more dramatically pitched mansard. That's the main reason for that. The weight of the roof would be cantilevered. It's too far inside the structure to structurally create enough of a point load down to not to create deflection on the floor beams. That's the main reason for some of the many of these changes.
unless you short and frame it a different way.
Well, the exterior wall are all load bearing, and the corridors are load bearing. Those are the only room. Those are the only areas that are load bearing. There was no way to have a load bearing offset inside a foot and a half to 2 feet. So that was the determination. We still have an overall look on Ansar to accommodate the feel of it. So
we just don't agree with that. I think if you look at the drawing that's behind you right now, it's not a mansard roof. There's no pitch. It's not a mansard roof. It's not a roof.
That is not representing the actual. But somehow.
That's fine. But that's the drawing I have to look at to analyze this. So if this is wrong, and in actuality was built, is the approved set from
2014
from 2 years ago?
Yeah.
Then we don't have to have this conversation. So let's have it next time when you've confirmed what.
I think it's in between. Is the answer, and we can confirm what that is. The way that it was drawn here, which is in the permanent set, is much steeper than what we proposed. And you know, I'm not going to opine on reasons that one might be better than another. What I think we need to do is find out exactly what it was pitched, you know, what the pitch of it is, how it was built, and confirm that the detailing that was supposed to go in is going to be going in, and that should help the
water. Yeah, because I'm unwilling to accept your argument about the structural loading, because we're not asking for a 27-foot cantilever. We're asking for a slightly different pitch mansard roof, which is a fairly traditional, common, and simple building practice. And so I, for you to say it wasn't feasible structurally, argument is not legitimate.
And what the architect's engineers were coming back and telling.
If the engineer would like to stand behind that, then he can come to this meeting and he can tell us that. But I would be very surprised to hear that come from him.
I'm not going
to
guess.
But again, we're going to continue this conversation because you believe that drawing is incorrect, which is, I don't know why we have that drawing here, because it doesn't make sense for us to analyze.
Well, it's a drawing that's been permitted. In other words, if we go back to the previous application, if I were to go and make the site match what was a building permit, I don't think that would be moving in the right direction. So what we need to do is figure out what gets the best solution. And I'm willing to help with that, which is what I'm doing here. So we'll go and measure exactly how it was built and what the detail of that is. I do know that it looks a lot better at the site than California. So our hope is that it's something that's closer to it. We can confirm what that is and bring that to you.
So if you could have for the next meeting a little bit more detail about the approved roof and the built roof and what will ultimately be, I think we can make some headway in that conversation.
What's your status with the windows and all that? Because that's something I'd like to get closed up.
Well, I mean,
I can say unequivocally that an EPDM roof is not. I mean, one visually expect.
No, I'm just. If you guys want to bring this back, I get it. But if you want to bring this back here, that EPDM roof shouldn't be on it. Because if it is, we're not going to talk about it. At least I'm not going to talk about it.
Well, let's then look at the pictures. Patty has some photos to show. Number one, number two, for a 1.5 roof pitch, oftentimes they're more prone to leak the EPDM, meaning that it's going to be mechanically fastened. Thirdly, it is, gentlemen can be the judge of what you can see from the street, from the aqueduct, to see if it warrants any EPDM. To me, it doesn't have any view. You can't really see it from anywhere. That's all we're proposing. It's a better sealed roof. So in the general public, it can't really be seen from anywhere, but that's my opinion on that. So.
I've installed both.
Did you have some?
Well, I did want to know what kind of drove the enclosure of the stairway at the back of the aqueduct and what that change was.
It's unfortunately a couple of things that Patty did. He just put an enormous amount of windows in there.
motor room to put in showers and things of nature. And the back was like an open space, why I don't know, but the furnace is going there, it's not temperature controlled, and the leaves and all that thrown in, that's why we feel it's the best thing to close it for in terms of security, in terms of animals getting in, the birds, leaves, snow, winter and rain, because there is a very windy area there.
It wasn't open through, right? I mean, it was just
it wasn't
open at
open
the
through.
Back through.
It was just open on the towards the outside.
So
okay. I don't.
I mean, I don't
personally. I don't have any issue with
that. I don't have any issue. I just wanted to know what drove it.
I didn't realize it going through the process. We did have four different drawings, and to keep the process moving, I never noticed the back was open until much later on.
Understood.
But you know, if you guys have a problem with the standing seam, I'm not saying that I have to have the EPDM roof. I was just making a statement from as a builder and things of that nature. So that's why we have photos. Obviously, refer to your expertise at the end.
So the front elevation and the east elevation seem to be the ones that have changed the least.
Right.
But then you get to the south elevation, and there's a lot going on there that's very different than the approved drawing.
With windows.
Yeah, windows with the size of the brick area versus the back. So, siding area. Here's that the width has changed. Openings have shifted. So I'm looking at the south elevation of the original plan from 11/19/14. And I'm looking at the bubble area. The existing block wall come in from the right side. You've got a mass that's brick and has four window bays across. And on the revised plan, you have a massive brick and only has three windows.
Yeah, but the mass is the same.
No, it's not. But first, if you look at the massing from the original drawing, I guess these are the garage openings below,
right,
where the rails are. They've actually shifted in position.
It's about 20% smaller, I'm talking about this one.
Yeah.
25%.
There was an alignment. They were both captured within the brick wall. They no longer are.
These three columns coming down to that,
mm-hmm.
And if we go to that, the opening comes on the other side. But I don't think it would have been open to that. It would have been to that other side. I think the opening wire.
Here it is. The change. This is this. It's a good looking.
It's a nice mass.
It's a nice massive with two windows, four and two. And this is something else, which is difficult to hear. You know,
the good by rights combo.
Something radically changed on the interior?
Yeah.
I think it's just the paint. This is garage level. I don't know why this is wider than thinner than that. That might just be drawings. There's nothing down there currently, just except the steel columns.
Yeah, maybe we should
take a look
at the drawing so you know that. Maybe they're inaccurate.
Yeah, I think the three windows with the two single window dormers, I think that looks better than the four and the doubles.
There were a lot more alignments on the south elevation. All the windows aligned straight up the building, and now they're sort of offset.
I mean, you don't have ambiguous alignments. You still have the alignments. That they're stacked,
but
you get the two windows on the end are sliding.
It's on the south elevation. It's not on the others. The others seem to be okay.
The south elevation really changed. It was before it was
clean.
There was a logic,
and it also didn't have plans of units. So I think
symmetry to north.
Plan, when it went into that stage, changes were made to make the units work.
That's why we
there's
a degree of
symmetry.
Yeah. I think the other thing here is to see that facade is very difficult. But I think that might be something that benefits from a sidewalk kind of thing.
I
Michael, do you think it makes sense to go out there?
Sure. It's fine. I think the first order of business is to accurately reflect in the drawings so that we can have those with us. It's not always as apparent the alignments that if there's debris or if there's not access. I think we want to be able to. We also consider what the neighbors see when they look. It may not be something that everyone looks at, but there may be people who are looking at this building, looking at the roof, looking at the sides of this, and to a lesser degree, we take that into consideration. It's still one that we consider. Would you? Do you agree? You want to take a look on the side?
Yeah.
But I think we need to have some updated drawings first,
okay.
And then we can take those, and we can spend a few minutes.
At this point, Carmine would like to get the windows in. If there are not objections about the windows.
I object to the south elevation entirely in terms of being able to install them, if that's what you're asking, because it's nowhere close to the approved plan.
In terms of location, but not type. I'm more talking.
You're talking about ordering the windows?
Well, the windows.
Or you have them. Because that would only impact ordering
the homes instead of the casements.
I think there's actually a case that's fine. It's a minor issue.
Type is fine. Change in type is fine.
Concern is location.
Correct.
On the south facade. Is the north facade as much of a concern, or is it really the south side?
This is like a proceed at your own risk type thing. You know that, right? This isn't, we're not.
No, I know.
Okay.
Yeah.
I could say whatever.
I'm not asking that about the windows. I'm asking that about whether there's as much of a concern about the north facade as there is the south. The reason I ask that is the north facade is more visible than the south facade.
Yes.
So.
It suffers from a little bit of the same problem as the south facade. However, it's much more visible from Elm Street.
Yeah, okay. Chestnut.
Chestnut.
So sequence is we go out and take dimensions so that we confirm actual sizes of some of the stuff. And we get that to you, and then based on that, you guys come back to the site?
I think that's the next step, yes.
And you don't have another meeting in December anyway, right? You're not meeting the day after Christmas?
No, I'm good.
No, it's the day after Christmas.
It's a national holiday. It's a national holiday.
I don't think so.
So the next meeting is that second Monday in January. So what I'll do is, if it's okay with you guys, I'll work to get those drawings put together so that you guys can pick your time and work for you over the holiday.
Okay. Sounds like a plan. I know we have some neighbors here. Everyone can. Just the application. Just this application.
Oh, right.
The other building is just not part of the conversation. So
there's a question I have enough for them. Nothing's bothering me. Maybe you can come over and look at it. If you could stand on the sidewalk and look at the building, 78 Main Street, and just is 4.5 floors. Now, how did that happen? I mean, is that first floor of 6658 is a floor and a half. It's not just a floor. It's a floor and a half. You can go over and look at it. And I'm just wondering if you were aware of that when you were here.
We were. I mean, is this a rhetorical question or are you, is this a legitimate one?
Because you
were here at all the meetings.
I know, but I didn't measure it. I didn't know. Let
me see what are you trying to.
My point is, this building is too high.
Okay, but.
Wait, hold on a second.
I know you were here at all the meetings because I remember.
I was in most of them.
Feels like you were here more than all, but I remember very specifically not being in favor of the fourth story. The fourth story was a question that ultimately went to the Board of Trustees, and I advised everyone here at the time to bring their concerns to the Board of Trustees about that fourth story. But it's not within our purview to approve or deny that fourth story. It's just not, I just don't have that tool in my arsenal.
Right. Well,
so that said,
we did
approve this four story with a very large first floor, and we did that for some site constraint issues, which in retrospect, we could have analyzed it a different way, and we did not. However, that part of the project,
right. It's too late.
It was a done deal.
Done deal.
And
well,
so I don't want to.
I'm just curious. What's going to go on that first floor? I mean, what kind of business is it? Just
a basketball court. I don't know.
Probably.
All man's shop.
But the thing.
All man's shop. Yes.
But the issue is, it's there.
It's there.
We approve that.
And I got to look at it for the rest of my life.
And we're going to make sure you look at a very nice roof when you do so.
I appreciate that because we do look down and we do see that roof.
And people walking down the street do.
Yes,
so I think that's
right,
it's a legitimate and legitimate concern. Thank you.
First of all, thank you very much. I think a thing that has been missing is accountability. In terms of when there is an approved building, an approved design, and I know you guys have tried hard and continue to, but what is built is, what should be built is what is approved. It shouldn't be a process of getting an approval, building what you want, and then coming in here and using a lot of words and negotiating. That's not the process. Frankly, if the fourth floor is not a proper mansard, order it removed. Get rid of it.
Yes, yes.
If they can't build the building that is approved, it should be taken down. There needs to be clear lines drawn, and there needs to be authority, and there needs to be accountability. So for all of your efforts in that regard, I thank you, and the community thanks you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Yep.
Mike Mara, I'd like to start with a question. On the back stairwell that's being closed, does that just come out on the garage or does that come out somehow in the backyard?
Garage. I see no, I'm sorry, would the applicant, could you answer that?
That goes directly into the garage.
Yeah, and I think this was part of an initial conversation that we had about, there were some doors that were on the aqueduct in one of the early schemes, and we didn't think that was appropriate. So the direct access was eliminated.
Right. So along those same lines, my big issue with the change is further encroachment on the aqueduct, where we're already talking about a building that's more over the aqueduct. To the extent that we've got more, balconies or egress or larger windows or, say, a higher front because of this extra height where we're taking away from what was supposed to be a mansard and now will be part of addition to the whatever floor that we counted at the top. Kind of like the sky exploder plane, I'm assuming that extra foot goes into the space on the top that's overlooking the aqueduct.
Let me see if I understand correctly what you're saying.
I understand your concern, but actually, if we look at the diagram of where the grade of the aqueduct is relative to the first floor of windows, we don't see any change.
This is what you're saying: the relationship of this element to the aqueduct.
Yeah. So kind of like if.
So this is what's being built is smaller than what's being approved. Is that your case?
So this is actually smaller.
You see, it looks smaller to me.
Well, remember, this was a foot higher.
Yeah, but 1 second. See, 10 feet.
So the discussion was that this point is still at the same elevation that was originally approved. Now, if that elevation is the same, then it's further out because we're flattening the roof instead of having a roof. Then we're farther out over the.
See, 10 feet here from the property line?
Right.
It's 10 feet from the property.
Yeah, yeah. So,
and this,
no, here,
but look at it.
This is distance, right?
Yeah.
No, different measurement, right? We're talking about whether this comes farther out into the aqueduct because of the height. Right? If you add more room, you've still encroached farther on the aqueduct. See what I'm saying?
Oh, that, well, that's the issue we were, I mean, that's the thing we were, that was our second
right,
point of contention.
With the mansard, right?
I thought you were talking about some line of the wall, which has not changed.
No, no.
But where is it, we, that's the issue that we,
right.
we're
but my primary contention is with the backside and the use of that public park, as somebody's backyard, to the extent and to the extent that you build farther over that or expose more and use it as visually as your backyard, you've essentially taken that away from the people who are using the aqueduct, which is a Dobbs Ferry resource and a state park resource, not somebody's private property.
Thank you. What else? All right, we have some additional work ahead of us on your part now. Make a motion to continue this to the next hearing. In your seconds, unanimous.
Yeah.
Thank you. We're just getting started. 7 Woodbine Terrace. It's
legalizing decks and fences.
Anyone here from 7 Woodbine Terrace? No. Motion to continue that to the next hearing. Second?
Yeah.
Yeah, your second is unanimous. 19 Seneca Street. Hello.
Hi, how are you? Thank you for being patient.
I have no presentation. I've submitted my application.
That makes us very happy.
Say yes or no.
Sorry, let me.
It's for this guy.
No, I brought you guys some samples for you.
Oh, great. Where is 19 Seneca? Oh, it's a fence.
Yeah.
Oh, wow, look at that.
That's beautiful.
It's a
nice fence.
You really going to put that fence in? All right, we're going to make it easy for you.
Part by part.
It's the exact
fence
style I'm using, but this is the cedar material.
Okay.
And this is the deer fence.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And what is the third fence type?
It's
fence.
It's the Illinois. Yeah. The Illinois fence is still cedar, but it is a different style. It's a picket.
Yeah, we got it. All three of them look very good. Any comments? No?
They're nice fences.
Okay. Your motion to approve, I second.
Unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice fence. 207 Ashford Avenue.
Yes.
Another fence. The benefits of waiting for so long mean that you...
For just impatient
much more amenable to... to applications.
Likewise, I do not have a presentation. I had submitted the materials. You should each have that. I have an extra copy for reference so you can see it. But we are also hoping to build a fence, a white picket fence, across the front property line of our three townhomes on Ashford Avenue. And it's something that we have been thinking about for a long time. What really prompted it most recently was bus stop that was added in front of one of our units on Ashford. And what's been happening is that when people come away from the bus, they come and sit up on our steps and they leave a lot of trash, and it's been going on for several months. And so we, at our town hall meeting, decided we really want to have a fence. But we want it to be a fence that is tasteful and consistent with the style of things in the neighborhood. And so we had chosen white picket fence made by Interstate, and it's the Illinois style. If you look in your packets, the sheet that has this picture is a good representation. I also brought sample materials here. So I'm happy to answer any questions, show you the materials, whatever you need.
And so you're turning the corner. So along Ashford, you're right next to the firehouse, these three houses, right?
Yes.
So there's the drive, and then are you returning the fence to the houses?
Yes, it is returning to the houses. And there is one
more there it
is.
Okay,
that's on the corner of Ashford and Clergy. We're not touching that, but it's simply our property line.
So you butt up into another fence that's already in place on that house on the corner? Or
yes,
do they have a hedge?
I believe the house on the corner, I believe, has a chain link fence. And we have also a bit of a stone wall that I think divides the property from the house on the corner. So I think we might be butting up against that stone wall.
Yeah.
The distance is about 83 feet in length. The fence will be about 3 feet high. It certainly will not exceed 4 feet, which I know is the requirement.
The gates even swing in, so I'm sure.
Yeah, I think we're... we're familiar
good.
With it. I think it looks. I think it looks fine.
We're
gonna see it.
We have to see the fence before.
And the rooftops will be local style because it's less prone to vandalism. This material is pretty solid, good quality. We asked a lot of questions about it. The style is more durable than the Carolina style, which is the wire pickets. Actually, it's made in the U.S. and it's. Supposedly holds up way better, because we noticed the property down the street where it isn't holding up so well. We said we don't want that type, so we specifically did a lot of research to find a good solid one, and we hope that it will look nice for a long time. So.
Okay, that's good.
Good.
Anything else?
No. Motion to approve this as submitted.
Yeah.
Dale seconds. Unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your patience.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it.
29 Manor House Lane. Motion to continue that application to the next hearing. Yeah, your seconds. Unanimous. 11 Magnolia.
Here. My name is Ed Brown. I'm here representing existing rear deck. The deck is approximately 30 by 20 feet. The pergola on top. The trim is
think we can. We have a. We got the picture.
So if you take a look at the back, the scale of that, the size of that, is, it grew approximately this much. And this little piece right there had a little deck going there and the original survey. It needs its coverage of setbacks.
I drive by this every day. Can't recall.
What's that?
Said I drive by this every day.
You can't see it.
Can't see it.
You cannot see it. It.
Because I'm on Magnolia.
It's in the setback, but I don't think it's covered.
No, it's because it's behind.
If you want to combine, I think you're a neighbor.
Neighbor.
With a 200-foot notice?
Probably. I didn't get a notice. I'm up on the back. I'm 260 Palisades, so I'm up on the back side.
I didn't even know Palisades was back there until I was finished walking. I said, I better take some photos from far away. I walked between the bushes and was right.
That's right. It's right there. Well, I mean, you can't.
It's okay. Where are you going, Stephanie?
I'm going to go that way.
I know it's good. The motion to approve has been submitted. Bill Seifert.
Oh, he came back.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
2014 and tonight.
103 Main Street?
Yes.
Are you here for 103
I'm
Main Street?
I'm here for 103 Main Street.
We might.
103 Main Street is a building that needs a lot of tender care. Mike Pompa.
Thank you. You're hired.
He does this in Irvington, so he's got his lines down. Okay, so a young man comes to town, he buys a building, two buildings actually, that need a lot of work. So he went in and he has renovated one of the apartments. And in doing that, he replaced three windows on the south side. And the question at this point is, what's the architectural review board's take on that, and do they have a concern, and how would they like us to address it? What I did is I provided you a photo that shows it. I've got better shots that I can put up on the screen if you want. Should I show them?
Sure. Just, is any more than what we have here? This.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't want to run off a whole bunch of prints of stuff. So I figured I'd just give you what kind of consolidated that. I mean, here's the two buildings that you're familiar with. And they're, you know, they're real classic Dobsbury Main Street buildings, but they have seen better days. And the thing that impresses me about Alfonso is that he wants to really fix these up. So he's making that effort. And here's the back of the building. You can see that it still needs some help. But they're doing that. He has fixed this one apartment because it became vacant, and he was able to go in and do things. So the three windows that you see here were changed. And what you can see is that, well, this one was probably close to the same window.
Right.
And this was, what was removed was the trim. This window was made slightly smaller than what was there. I think that's the bathroom window. Or is that the kitchen
above the sink?
Okay. That's the kitchen. And then this other one, same deal. It was, you know, pretty much the same size window. But it was, you know, it's a different window than the other windows in the building. Now, these three windows are on that alley side. So one of the problems with taking the photo even is getting a vantage point that you can see them. This is a window that's on the floor above, which shows what the trim was on the building. And it also shows, I wasn't trying to be dramatic here, but it also shows what he's dealing with. It's not like he went in and tore out some really nice trim and put in a window without trim.
Oh, I understand. I think, let's just make this short and sweet so people can. If you're going to change the window opening or the detail around it, that's gotta come to the board. And obviously, any work that gets done needs to be properly permitted through the building department. So, you know, those things go without saying. If you're going to replace a bunch of windows, or you're going to have a whole plan for how to deal with the building, come to us once. We'll look at it cohesively, and you start picking it apart as the units become vacant, and you have access to them, or you know, however you decide to do that. I don't know that there's anything for us to do tonight. I mean, are you?
Well, wait. I mean, do you want us to do a drawing? I mean, I'd love to not have to do it because I don't think it's going to.
What if you're changing window sizes, and you're removing or adding trim? Those are items that come before us. If you're replacing the window in kind with another window in an alleyway, there's nothing for us to opine on.
Right. Well, two of the windows are effectively the size of what the windows were, but it's the missing trim. You can kind of tell. The other one being slightly smaller, so it fits above the sink, is that an issue of concern to you? And what I'd rather, I mean, how do you feel about your trim? If you had to put the trim in, would you be willing to do that?
Yeah.
So would it might be, I mean, we can do a drawing that shows the windows with the trim. I mean, I don't want to be going in and measuring up the building to.
I understand. You know, this is a. It's a procedural question when certain procedures seem excessive when taken in certain contexts. However, it is part of the procedure, and you know, changing window sizes, changing trim is one of the important things that we look at. And so, I understand it's an alleyway. I understand it's a minor change, but you know, I think to maintain transparency and
sure.
the proper procedure, it's something that we can do. You can do it simply. You don't need we don't need all four elevations. It can be a humble drawing.
Just the elevation.
To expedite side. The process. Any issues with, is there any other issues that have come up?
Rear elevation and the door as well.
Well, if there's other elevations that are affected, then
yeah,
we go to the window.
Where those were changed to?
Door, yeah.
Okay, a window?
Yeah.
Okay.
So wherever any affected area
okay.
that you're not changing in kind.
A simple drawing, very simple drawing with a photograph, corresponding photograph would do.
Yeah.
Is he good with permits and everything now?
Yeah, I guess.
Okay, well, maybe I haven't seen him yet, plus I haven't been issued.
Have an issue
with
this,
okay.
Yeah.
So we're moving in the right direction.
We'll work on my pile of things to do.
So we will help Alfonso because I think it's very important that you know, these kind of smaller buildings that you know they're the ones that will make the difference in the future when the downtown really starts to feel like what it can be.
Okay.
We'll continue to the next. Next hearing.
Sounds exciting.
Yep.
Any seconds? Yeah, here. Unanimous. Okay, thanks.
Thank
good
you.
Luck.
Thank you.
Good night.
We have minutes. Start with the May 23rd. Motion to approve the May 23rd minutes.
Second.
Brandon seconds. Dale abstains. Yeah, you're voted in favor. June 13th, 2016.
No, you're not here.
Good night, guys.
Good night. Oh, this was that. Good.
June 14, there are two mistakes. Page
4 and page 6. Michael shows up instead of me, even though he was not the one.
It's on the vote, it's a mistake.
Here.
4-0.
Michael
was
absent.
Michael was absent everywhere else, but he showed up on that vote.
Page 4 of 6.
And 6 of 6.
And 6 of 6 on the vote. Dale was present and voted A, and Michael was not. Consistent at all. Second.
Unanimous.
Unanimous.
On one abstain.
Not yet. Michael abstained. Michael.
Next are the June 27th, 2016. Motion to approve the June 27, 2016
second.
Minutes. Yeah, your seconds. Unanimous. To do that. And for July 11th. Item number 9, page 5 of 6, 49 Clinton, it doesn't say what the motion is. It just says it passes. I'm not sure if that was the meeting where we finally approved it or not. don't know if we can't approve it because we don't know what this.
We have to put a motion by.
Well, I actually don't know what the motion was.
When the obviously passed, right?
Well, it could have been to continue.
Well, previous, what is it, 49?
Continue, that application went on for several meetings, and I don't know which one we finalized it. So that's why I'd like to continue this to the next until we have some clarification.
The prior one was.
I know, but they were here 5, 6 times at least.
That has to be clarified.
Yes.
I think that's where we approve the color.
Yeah, it's
just say, I know it needs to be clarified.
Let's continue until we have the clarification. Motion to continue the July 11, 2016 minutes.
Second.
Dale seconds, unanimous. Motion to adjourn to next meeting.
Second.
In your seconds, unanimous. Meeting adjourned.